Hi there, I'm Stacey Ross. Welcome to the CHEK Spotlight, a special feature of Rising Economy Week, which we are very pleased to sponsor. Now, this conference happening this week focuses on big, bold adventures and challenges and ideas in our post-pandemic economy. Find out more and sign up for free at ourrisingeconomy.com. Today, we feature Emilie de Rosenroll, startup CEO of Coast, an exciting new initiative to develop Pacific Canada's next ocean and marine hub right here on the South Island. Carrie Slavin's South Island Prosperity Partnership will chat with Emilie about Coast's plans to put Greater Victoria on the world stage for the blue economy. Over to you, Carrie.
Good afternoon. Around the globe, it seems everyone is talking about the global blue economy, which Canada's ocean supercluster estimates will double in size to $3 trillion by 2030. The rise of this blue economy has inspired a tsunami of competition around the world, and it's inspired many people to wonder where Canada, the country with the world's longest coastlines, fits. To find out, we're talking today with Emilie de Rosenroll, CEO of Coast, which stands for the Center for Ocean Applied Sustainable Technologies. Coast has set out an ambitious vision to become Canada's next Pacific hub for the sustainable blue economy, headquartered right here in Greater Victoria and on the South Island. Welcome, Emilie.
Hi, Carrie. It's great to be here.
It's great to see you. So we know that in the just the last couple of weeks, you were announced as the CEO of Coast and your CEO of South Island Prosperity Partnership, which is the region's economic development alliance. And I know that South Island Prosperity is going to steward Coast through its startup phase. Can you talk about how this all fits? And I have no doubt people who know you very well say they have no doubt you will handle both CEO jobs mightily.
Oh, well, that's really kind, Carrie. I have to first say that it's a massive honor to be able to do this, to be able to sort of start up the organization and be the first CEO. But of course, this is a big effort of a lot of really phenomenal partners and founders. And so this is just the next evolution in that process. And if it weren't for members like the Association of BC Marine Industries and the Ocean Networks Canada, Babcock Canada, also BC Ferries and many other SMEs and other partners as well, we wouldn't be here.
Okay, well, it sounds like a lot of people and a lot of organizations have come together. So first of all, tell us exactly what Coast is and why do we need it here?
Absolutely. Well, Coast is what we call a cluster, a blue economy cluster, and also a hub, an innovation hub. And so what does that really mean? It means it's a place where we can bring together the interests of different parties, from large industry to small innovator, to research institutions, and bring them all together into a space where companies will be able to access shared equipment and testing facilities. They'll be able to work together on common problems. They'll be able to understand better global market opportunities to be able to find a path to market for their technologies and innovation. And also bring access to training and education and opportunities for our students here in Greater Victoria and other places to come and work on global ocean challenges.
Okay, great. And smaller countries like Norway, for example, have become leaders in the blue economy. What have they been doing that we haven't been doing? Have we lacked that kind of hub culture?
Yeah, well, I think Canada historically hasn't done a lot of work in this area called cluster development. And the work that they have done has been maybe a little bit smaller scale than countries like Norway, where they've put in, you know, significant investments in those areas. So we're sort of definitely becoming more of a cluster expert country with the new super clusters over the last few years that have been growing steadily and represent a really big evolution for our history as a country. So it's definitely becoming something that's more common. But in Norway, there are, you know, there are dozens and dozens and dozens of ocean clusters alone.
Right. Okay. Well, it sounds pretty exciting. And I know that the concept of Coast And the reality of coast has been really strongly endorsed by the local ocean and marine industries. Why do you think that is? Why is there so much excitement around this?
Well, I think that we've definitely struck a chord. There's a massive amount of demand to be able to bring together these ecosystem partners. And of course, if you're a company that's maybe a startup or a scale up growing in that space, you don't always have the chance to really think a bit broader about your whole sector industry. So this is a way that we can sort of pull together resources and information and opportunities for partnership and trade and export, and be able to bring those together into one focal point. So it's really a big sort of accelerator for companies, and certainly the demand is there.
Okay. And that's so great to know. And that sort of plays into the next question, why this is so significant specifically for the Pacific region. We've always heard about the Atlantic Canada and, you know, associated that with maritime industries and whatnot, but the Pacific has always seemed a little quieter. So why is this so significant for our region and for Greater Victoria and the South Island in particular?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, we're not really well known for our ocean economy, despite the fact that we have a massive and very rich and varied coastline here in British Columbia. It's a wonderful place for testing opportunities, and there's all sorts of opportunities around the coastline for environmental monitoring and so on. So it's definitely a big factor for us. What we find is that Atlantic Canada has sort of become more known, more on the map for its ocean technology and marine technology. And so we're sort of playing a little bit of catch up, but I think that's actually really just telling the story better. And we certainly have a lot of strong technology companies here in British Columbia, and their technologies can certainly be applied to the ocean sector. So our ocean sector will be a little different than the sector that we see out in the Atlantic coast. It will be a strong complement and leverage. We're building a partnership with the Ocean Supercluster and other Atlantic partners, Atlantic-based partners like the Ocean Startup Project. And so we're gonna see, I think, some quick leapfrogging of our industries here as we're able to leverage some of the natural strength of our economy here and be able to kind of move things ahead faster.
That's great to hear. And is it significant? I mean, we're part of the Pacific Northwest region. Does that play a role in your thinking? I mean, geographically, we're close to Vancouver, we're close to Seattle, we're surrounded by the Salish Sea. I mean, geographically, it seems like we're well positioned. So how does that hold up within the Pacific Northwest as a whole?
Well, one of our big ambitions is really going to be to build up this this community of Pacific Rim nations, and they all have a lot in common, a lot of trade opportunities, a lot of ways to build sort of partnerships and customers and so on. So this is, I think, a big part of our competitive advantage in this part of the world, being in this Pacific Northwest region. It's a massive, massive economy. If you look at it at the agglomerate level, it's also, it's also an area that is highly, highly populated and a massive economic powerhouse. So we've got a lot of opportunities here, a lot of strong partners that have already been developed. And I think that's going to be a big part of our story going forward.
So speaking of that story, what are Coast priorities over the next few years? I imagine there are some pretty big challenges and opportunities.
Absolutely. Well, the ocean, the ocean economy in general is growing so quickly, as you said. It's growing actually 20% faster than other sectors in the economy, and it's set to double by 2030 from where it was in 2010 to $3 trillion. So we're going to just keep asking more and more from our oceans, and the demand for innovative ocean products is never going to be greater than it is today, and of course, even greater tomorrow. So we're going to ask everything from our oceans, from food and energy to shipping and environmental monitoring. So there's really a ton of opportunities ahead of us. So that's certainly what's really exciting, I think, about our future. What we can see is that there are a lot of challenges where the ocean is a really good focal point for that. Things like, how do we speed up the decarbonization of our economy? How do we create more green jobs? How do we create economic opportunities in areas that are also sustainable and offer opportunities for more people, so they're also inclusive?
So is it fair to say then that the blue economy is actually green economy, synonymous with that?
Well, that's a good way to say it. I think that's true. I think that the blue economy is pretty synonymous with sustainability. And so that's what the majority of the world kind of understands when they hear the word blue economy. So in a way, I suppose it is green, but I think we wouldn't want to confuse anybody by calling it a sort of blue green economy.
Absolutely not. And, you know, we've talked about the environment. I know this is significant for studying climate change, developing new technologies, all kinds of things. But what does it actually mean for our economy and the people of our region? Jobs, maybe well-paying jobs.
Yeah, so the blue economy represents some really, a variety of different jobs, very interesting jobs. It really touches a whole bunch of industries and sectors. And those are jobs that are, you know, they're transferable to other parts of our economy as well. So a lot of the skills that are in demand in the ocean sector are skills that are in demand across our economy. I think that we can invest in the ocean economy safely and be knowing that we're building up opportunities for future generations that are really going to be jobs that are going to last and be required and needed. We need to do more of that. We need to make the economy work for society and work for some of these major challenges and areas that we know are going to be, you know, generation defining things like climate change. So how are we actually leveraging our economy to do a much better job than we've done before?
Okay. And just flipping CEO hats here for a minute, I want to ask you, as CEO of South Island Prosperity Partnership, you've often talked about diversifying our economy here on the South Island and developing resilience. We've been very resource dependent, traditional resources, forests, you know, mining in BC. And of course, in Victoria itself, tourism is big, tech is big. How does this play into it? Is this going to further strengthen our resilience?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. So, the ocean sector really touches everything from tourism to technology. So for Greater Victoria, it's a natural fit. From my role as CEO of South Island Prosperity Partnership, we believe strongly that the sectors that we should be promoting are really ones that promote our resilience, our sustainability, our inclusion and equity. So absolutely, this is one of those sectors that we're most excited about at SIP, and it was a real natural fit for us to be able to take this on.
Right. I think that's really interesting opportunity for the region. You haven't said anything about, is this going to be a decentralized hub somehow, or are you looking for locations? What's happening in that area?
Yeah, good question, Carrie. So we're really looking at a hub and spoke model, multiple sites. And so we're trying to be creative about how we look at how we use space these days and how we create networks across geographies. So we'd like to be able to include more remote locations and build that into the story. And of course, Indigenous communities are a big part of our focus. And we're partnered with Sauk Nation and Chief Planis is on our advisory board. So we're definitely looking at some of the different partnerships that we can have and how to expand our sort of quote unquote footprint. But we're looking right now also at a central location that would have water access. And so the spot that we're looking at right now is actually the Ogden Point Breakwater District, where there's deep water access, which would be incredible for so many of the companies in our region.
That's fabulous. And speaking of companies, are there any major partnerships that you're ready to announce at this stage?
Well, I can certainly speak to some of our founders and just one example, because we have many, but Babcock Canada is one of our core founding members. And we are going to be designing right now a foundation project to be able to look at some of their needs and how can we work with smaller companies and build something of value together that would really make a mark for this area. So I can't say more than that at this point, but certainly there'll be more announcements to come in the new year.
I appreciate that. And I appreciate also that you're mentioning that small businesses will be part of this opportunity that's happening. There's not just a focus on the big, big companies, but it seems like it's really crossing the whole spectrum. What does the launch of COAST say about your hope for the future of our region, the future of the planet? I mean, I know you're very, you have a reputation for being very visionary, but what does that say about your hope for the future?
Well, I think that fundamentally, we're at SIP and at COAST, we're trying to create the future that we want for the next generation. You know, I'm a mother of two very young girls, a six-year-old and two-year-old, a husband in entrepreneurship. And of course, we want to be able to live out many, many years here. Can't think of a better place to call home, but we know that, you know, the affordability issue is becoming more and more of a challenge, a real barrier for a lot of companies' growth, and definitely something that's going to impact our kids. So I think that the idea is, how do we build those opportunities that are going to keep the next generation here in Greater Victoria, keep their options open?
I think that's fabulous. I want to mention that COAST, you can find out more during Rising Economy Week. COAST will be playing a big role on some of the panels. There's one on the rise of the Pacific, in which a panel will be discussing more about COAST and the opportunities out there. And you can also tune in to hear more about COAST from one of the founding members, Julie Angus of Open Ocean Robotics. And apparently, Julie also has rowed across the Atlantic in a rowboat. So she's also a co-founder of COAST. And so they will be talking a lot about the blue economy during Rising Economy Week. Emilie, I know you'll be there. If you'd like to register for Rising Economy Week, it is free. It is in-person and virtual, mix and match, make your own conference. Go to rrisingeconomy.ca. Emilie, thank you so much for being here today. We'll look forward to hearing more about COAST.
Thanks, Carrie. A pleasure to be here. And if people want to find out more about COAST, they can go to canadacoast.com and they can sign up to our newsletter to be part of COAST Talks and some other events that are coming up. So thanks again for the opportunity.